Very good morning. So last time in the last lecture, we have introduced one of the very important distribution which you are going to use in sampling the data later on. Okay, and which is naturally arising from the normal distribution. Okay, right. So which is defined as the sum of square of independent standard normal random variables. Okay, and whose distribution can be identified in terms of gamma distribution. Okay, and so we know about this, what is the corresponding density function for this. Okay, and what will be the mean of this random variable, what will be the possible variance, because we know the things about gamma distribution. So the results will be simply applicable here as well. So I'm just going through once, just a little bit overview what we have done in the last lecture. Since it is a long gap, it's going to be gap almost. Okay. So the chi-square distribution, so if is identified by this following sum. Okay, this is the sum of square normal random variables where each zi follows the standard normal distribution. So by mean of standard normal distribution means it's a normally distributed with mean 0 and variance 1. Okay, then we say that such random variables, so this is going to be sum of random variables, is will also going to be a random variable. Okay, so this random variable is said to have a chi-square distribution. So since we have taken n number of independent standard normal random variables here, so we call that with n degrees of freedom. Okay, and we denote it by chi n square. Okay, so suffix n denotes the degree of number of degree of freedom, and that 2 denotes here squared, means here because we have taken squared standard normal random variables. Okay, then it is this is why here 2 is here in superscript, because okay, right. Now the last time we have also seen sum of the chi square density function with n equals to 1, with n equals to 3, with n equals to 10. We have that where we have seen last time this plot. Okay, and we were trying to identify what will be the possible moment generating function for this chi and chi square distribution. Okay, and that we have identified because each zi is independent. Okay, so they are independent random variable. So z1 square, z2 square, and so on, zn square will also be independent. So we have used that property here that they are independent random variables. Okay, so this makes our life easy here because of the independence. So the moment generating function by definition is going to be expectation of e to the power dx. Okay, so x is nothing but chi n square, and since chi n square is z1 square plus z2 square plus and so on plus zn square, so I can certainly write it as, because I use the property that e to the power a plus b is equals to e to the power a into e to the power b, that will also be applicable here. Okay, so that is going to be e to the power tzi square, or it is e power tz1 square into e to the power tz2 square, and so on. So then since because this zi squares are independent, so therefore e to the power tzi square also independent random values. So that's all. Again, we have used the fact that x is independent of x comma y are independent random variables. I just write here. Okay. X and y are independent random variables, then so is g of x and h of y. So that you had already in your one of the tutorial exercise. Okay, so when you have x and y are independent, in that case expectation of x into y is expectation of x into expectation of y, because their covariance is zero. So from that definition you will get it. Okay, and so this is going to be equals to, so this is justified that this is going to be equals to pi, product of I equals to 1 to n expectation of e to the power t z I square. Okay, so then we so after this we have struggled for finding the e to the power t z square, where z is a standard normal variate, because each one is going to be the same repetition of it is in the product here. So we are going to substitute this. So if you look at the density of z and apply this the definition of expectation of g of x, if you recall, okay, so this is going to be here. So now what you will do is you have to adjust everything, okay, a nice way, okay, and then what you have got is expectation of e to the power t z square is this sigma bar, which is nothing but 1 minus 2t to the power minus 1 by 2. So we have made this substitution because t is fixed for 6t, we are looking for moment generating function. So later on we will vary it. Okay, right. So once you have expectation of t times z square is equals to this, so then certainly for, so it is, see, right hand side is not here depending on z. So nowhere here z is going to be some number for fixed t. So if t z1 square is also this, e to the power t z2 square is also this, and on e to the power t z1 square expectation is the same. So if they are sitting in the product, so they are n time. So what you will observe is expectation of e to the power t z I square is 1 minus 2 t to the power minus n by 2. Okay, and we have seen that moment generating function, this is a moment generating function for gamma distribution. Okay, so this is a moment generating function for gamma distribution by, if you recall, if x follows the gamma distribution with parameter alpha comma lambda, then its moment generating function is given by lambda y lambda minus t to the power alpha. So here if you rewrite everything, here lambda equals to 1 by 2 and t alpha is equals to n by 2. So chi m square will follow the gamma distribution with parameter alpha equals to n by 2 and lambda equals to half. Also, we have noted down that expectation of x in this case was alpha by lambda. Okay, and variance of x was alpha by lambda square. We have seen that. Okay, so therefore this implies expectation of this chi random chi square distribution is going to be, so what is alpha is n by 2, lambda is 1 by 2, that is n, and variance of chi n square is going to be, you have alpha by lambda square, so this is going to be 1 by 4, n by 2 divided by 1 by 4, that is going to be 2n. Okay, so we have identified both the mean and variance of chi square distribution. Okay, right, by looking at the gamma distribution. So now, like in the case of standard normal variable, normal random variable, we have seen the table of we have the normal table and how to identify the values that we have seen. Similarly, for the chi square distribution as well, we have the table. Okay, so we will have the table in this form for different value of alpha, for different values of n. I'm going to zoom it soon. Okay, we are going to find out. So what is the definition of this, how this you have to evaluate is, so it's the notation, because square here, because of this is denoting the chi square distribution, and alpha is because it is denoting the value from alpha belongs to 0 to 1. Okay, that probability value. So probability value. Okay, and this then quantity, this is a quantity x square alpha comma n. So n is the number of degrees of freedom for chi square distribution. Okay, so how it is defined is, if x follows chi square distribution with n degree of freedom, then for any alpha in open interval 0, the quantity x, this x square alpha comma n, which is denoted by this, is defined to be such that the probability of x greater than equals to x square alpha comma n, so this value is equals to alpha. So this alpha here and this alpha is related. Okay, so here it is C. So now it is above x, this means after x square, what is the area covered by the chi square distribution? That is what it is giving you. Okay, what is before is the total area is 1. You have to define, you have to man minus by alpha. So that will give you this. Okay, right. Okay, so let's look at this problem here. Okay, so we have to identify this chi square 26 probability, which is less than equals to 30. Okay, so we want to identify this. Now look at in the table. So I'm going to so it is means like you are considering. So if you look at this first part, I'm looking at this part, first part, I'm interested in finding probability of chi square 26 less than equals to 30. What is the possible approximation of this value? Okay, and I want to relate it with the available table with me. Okay, right. So it is telling you that you are considering the number of degrees of freedom is 26. Okay, right. So this is certainly, it is equals to, I should say here, 1 minus probability of chi square 26 greater than equals to 30, because we are going to look at on the right of this. Okay, from the table you will get on the right of, from the right. Okay, right. So now let's look at the table, and I, let me zoom it. Okay, I think this value is, these are visible now. Okay, so now see here. So you have the values of x square alpha comma n. So these are the values corresponding. Alpha is 0.99, 0.995, 0.97. So it is of the interval, I think it is showing you 0.005 here. So 0.995 plus 0.005, 0.99 plus 0.01 plus point. So it is alpha here, it is 1 minus alpha here, if you look at this side. Okay, or if it's alpha, if you look at this side, it is 1 minus alpha in this side. Okay, right. So now this is the area covering from the left. Okay, from the right. So what it is giving you is telling you probability of x greater than equals to x square alpha comma n. Now what I'm interested in, I'm interested in when x square alpha comma n is equals to 30. But here alpha is given, n is given in the, my case is n is number of degree of freedom is 26. So I have to certainly scroll down to the value n equals to 26. Okay, so I have to scroll down the row where this 26 is sitting. So if you look at, okay, if you look at this row, this is a 26. Now where this 30 value is sitting, 30 value is sitting, this 15.379 and 38.885 in between that. Okay, so these values are here. Okay, so you can see that value of this at 30, okay, greater than equals to 30 will lies between here. So greater than equals to 15.379, the value is somewhere, I mean, it, you will see the corresponding alpha here. Okay, and you will see the corresponding alpha in this case. So the value will be lying, must lie in between that. Okay, so certainly what we'll have is, I have, this is 15.379 is, if I have this table. Okay, so you may have another table as well. Okay, so maybe online there are not, big table will be available. Okay, so from there you may get the more accurate value. So in the row n equals to 26, number or the degree of freedom, okay, is 26. Look at the rows, look at the columns where 30 value lies inside the interval. Okay, so that will correspond to what value now is if I'm going through this, means I'm going to make a arrow here. So we are going in this direction and between this interval. Okay, right. So sorry. So let me make it up. Yes. So it is for, so it is, you know, probability of x greater than equals to 15.379 is equals to 0.95, and probability of x greater than equals to 38.885 is equals to 0.05. Okay, so the value of probability of x greater than equals to 30 will certainly lie between 0.05 less than equals to probability of x greater than equals to 30 less than equals to 0.95. So this is the only estimate you will get from the table. Okay, you will not be able to get the exact value from here. Okay, so for getting the exact value, you certainly require a program. Okay, so what is that program is? So you are going to have MATLAB. If you have worked with MATLAB, so you can certainly look for the program log coil. You can search, you can type on the command window chi2cdf, because you are trying to identify the distribution function. Okay, because x greater than equals to, so you have to certainly fix the parameter. Okay, the value, number of degree of freedom. Okay, and the x square alpha comma n value. Okay, so let me give you, that's going to be here. If you want to try with MATLAB, it is 30,26. Okay, so first parameter will be the x square value. Second parameter will be the number of degree of freedom in here from MATLAB program. Okay, and what will be the value here in approximately will be, I can give you that. Now that value, if you run that program, okay, so if you run that program, what will be the possible value will be somewhere like 0.1. Okay, that will be coming out like 0.1. So you can certainly say, so 0.90 it will come, because see, it is more near to 30. 30 is more near to 38. So it will be certainly around something like 0.7 and 0.9 somewhere. Okay, so it will be coming about 0.9. Okay, so something like 0.9. And then you are interested in 1 minus probability of that, that's going to be 1 minus 0.9 is 0.1. Okay, so you have to take the help of MATLAB here. So chi2cdf, you can work with it. Okay, with first parameter is the x square value, that at after we or means you are looking on the left of it. Okay, so on the on the right of it, so x greater than equals to, okay, means, okay, so if you look at like this, so you are looking at this side, right of it. So this is your x square alpha comma n value. So you are looking on this side, probability of x greater than equals to. Okay, so this table or this program only work for that. Okay, right. So this is how you will get the probability of this sub x chi square 26 less than equals to 30, that is going to be come out as sub point. For the B part, it is given to you. Okay, x square 0.05,15. So you have, it is very, you have to follow the pattern here. So this is alpha comma n. So n is the number of degree of freedom is 15, and corresponding value alpha is 0.05. So I can certainly look at the table and see alpha equals to 0.05 is here, n equals to 15 is sitting here, 24.996. That can be certainly tell from this cell. Okay, that value is 24.996. Okay, right. So this is how you will look at the chi-square distribution table. Okay, right. Now let's look at the application of it. Let's look at one problem. Okay. Suppose that we are attempting to locate a target in 3D space. Okay, and that the three coordinate errors. So we have coordinate errors are in meters. Okay, of the point chosen are independent normal random variables with mean 0 and standard deviation 2. So we are looking in three dimension space. It is one dimension, you can say x1, x2, x3, three dimensional space, these three coordinate. Okay, right. And then we have seen from the three coordinate error of the point chosen are independent normal random variables with mean 0 and standard deviation 2. Okay, right. Find the probability that the distance between the point chosen and the target exceeds 3 meters. Okay, so we want to look at the distance between the point chosen and. Okay, so the distance, how it will be calculated from the point is, you know, square root of x minus x naught square plus y minus y naught square plus z minus z naught square. Okay, so that formula will take place here. So let us solve this problem. Okay, let xi, okay, denotes the error in the ith coordinate. Okay, that xi denotes the error in the ith coordinate. So I equals to 1, 2, 3. Now, certainly, if the between the point chosen and target, so you can certainly start with your origin. Okay, otherwise, you can, means like you can you can say wherever you are standing, that is your origin. Okay, right. So certainly, you know what is the distance. If you denote d by distance, okay, so that is going to be d square, that is going to be x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square. So that's again going to be a random variable with some of these three variables. And it is given that, okay, it is given that each coordinate error follows where, given that it is given that each xi follows normal distribution with mean 0 and standard deviation is 2, so means 4, with variance 4. So I am interested, so because it looks like sum of squared normal random variables. So what I can do here, instead of working with standard, means like a normal random variable, we should work with the standard normal random variables. So means we can, certainly we can make it standard normal. Why? Because you can work with xi minus mean 0, that divide by standard deviation, that is 2. So that will follow. So that will follow normal distribution with 0 mean and 1 variance. So I'm going to work with that. So instead of x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square, I will work with x1 by 2, x2 by 2, x3 by 2 whole square. So d square by 4 it will come. Okay. So this will give me, this implies d square by 4 is equals to x1 square by, you have 4 plus x2 square by 4 plus x3 square by 4. Which I can certainly write as z1 square plus z2 square plus z3 square, where each zi is follows the normal distribution with 0 mean and 1 variance. Zi is equals to nothing but the xi by 2, I equals to 1, 2 and 3. And we note that this is nothing but chi3 square. So it's a chi-square random variable with 3 degrees of freedom. Okay. So what we are interested in? We are interested in to finding the probability that the distance between the point chosen and the target exceeds 3 meters. Means what we are interested in. So we wish to find probability that t square is greater than 9. The distance is greater than 9. So this is going to be probability of, you know, d square by 4 follow the chi square distribution. So I will work with d square by 4 greater than 9. Okay, so that's going to be probability of chi 3 square is greater than 9. Sorry, 9 by 4. Okay, so this is going to be probability that chi 3 square is greater than 2.25. So there are two ways. Okay, so there are two ways to identify this value. Okay, there are two ways to identify this value. One is by running the program, or you can find the estimate by looking at the table. Okay, so if you look at the chi square value, 3 degrees of freedom means you are going to certainly look at this column. So 2.25 will lies between here, so 0.352 and 7.815. So certainly the value lies between 0.05 to 0.95. Okay, so that only estimate can be given. Okay, right. So now this is going to be, I will give you the value so that you can find out by using the, you have, this is the chi2 CDF function that also you can look at. Okay, so that certainly belongs to, I can say, 0.05 to 0.95 from the chi square table that I can give you. Okay, so I hope this is the, here it is alpha comma n. Okay, right. So it is CDF. So I think this is CDF. So CDF is always less than equals to. Okay. So you should keep in that mind that this is going to be CDF, means probability of x less than equal to 30, it will give you. So that's why it is going to be 1 minus 0.9 for our case. So chi to CDF will give you 30 comma 26, means. So I'm again going to write this down here is equals to 1 minus, so you can try with this function chi2 CDF with the at value 2.25 and with number of degree of freedom is 3. Okay, so that value you can calculate by using the function. Okay, right. Now if instead of looking in the three-dimensional space, if you look at in the two-dimensional space. Okay, so suppose the things are same. Okay, suppose the things are same, and if you would try to attempt it in two-dimensional space, and the again the coordinate errors are independent normal random variables with mean 0, and you have standard deviation is 2, then find the probability that distance between the point chosen and the target exceeds 3. Then you will again like to use the same method. So it's now in the case of in the, so in the case of in the case that target in two-dimensional space, it means we need to locate. Okay, in the case. Okay, that means attempt to locate a target in two-dimensional space. So everything is same. So you have d square is, you have x1 square plus x2 square. Okay, and this implies d square by 4 is equals to x1 square by 4 plus x2 square by 4. So this is going to be follows the chi-square distribution with 2 degree of freedom. Okay, and we know chi-square distribution, okay, will follow the gamma distribution. Okay, so gamma distribution, alpha is n by 2, so n is 2, so 2 by 2, comma 1 by 2. So n by 2, comma 1 by 2. So that is nothing but gamma distribution with 1 comma half. And if you recall, the gamma distribution with alpha equals to 1 is nothing but the exponential distribution. Okay, so whenever, see, you can say that whenever you are going to have degree of freedom is even number, so you can certainly look at the gamma distribution, which is turns out to be a, here when alpha equals to 1, it is a, it's going to be a gamma distribution with the 2n, if it is have 2n, this is n comma 1 by 2. Okay, and you can certainly look at the density function of gamma distribution, and you can try to identify the value of probability. So now you can identify that probability of d square is greater than 9, that is going to be nothing but probability of d square by 4 is greater than 9 by 4, that is 2.25. And now since this exponential distribution with lambda is equals to 1 by 2, so this is certainly, you know, if you recall what is the distribution function of what is the distribution function for exponential distribution, if you recall that fx of x, it was 1 minus e to the power minus lambda x, if you recall that. Okay, so, and if you recall, this is probability of x less than equals to x. Now, what is probability of x greater than x is e to the power minus lambda x, and that is going to be e to the power minus lambda is 1 by 2 and x is 2.25. Okay, so that's in total is 9 by 8, and that is going to be approximately something around 0.3247. Okay, right, in two-dimensional space, it will follow the gamma distribution, means exponential distribution, and that can be handled easily instead of looking at the chi-square distribution, right? Okay, so another natural distribution which arises from the normal distribution again, okay, is going to be identified as t-distribution, okay? So which is nothing but the defined as the ratio of the standard normal random variable and square root of chi-square distribution with means like divide by n, means you have made it like a average of sum of squared normal random variables, okay, and then take the square root. So that will be defining the another distribution which is known as t-distribution, and that has very nice property. Okay, so this is why this is important, okay, that you are going to learn. So, okay, right. So here the numerator is z follows normal distribution with mean 0 and 1, and chi square is a, this x, this y square is a chi square distribution, and then if the, then this ratio, you say, is said to have t distribution with n degrees of freedom. Okay, now if you look at the plot of this for different values of n, okay, so density function of the t distribution, so with different n you have different bell shaped curve, it looks like a normal curve only, okay, so it is going to be symmetric about the zero, okay, it is going to be symmetric about the zero, so this is zero line, okay. Further, when you can see as n is increasing, okay, so then more and more that it looks like a standard normal density. Okay, then it looks like a standard normal density. Moreover, it is looking like if you increase n, what is happening is it is becoming thicker. Okay, the tails are becoming thicker as well. With the thicker tails, you can say. Okay, right. So now we we can certainly look at the property of more properties of this. Okay, right. Now, this is a plot for T density with n degrees of freedom, 5 degrees of freedom, which looks like almost a standard normal density. Why it is so? Because of the central limit theorem that will give you the theoretical base. Okay, right. So now if you look at the very first thing I want to look at is expectation of this random variable chi square divided by n is nothing but 1 by n time expectation of chi n square, and that you have already noted down, that is expectation of chi square distribution is n only, and that is come out as 1. Okay, right. And now see, each, so here chi n square, if you look at this, so chi n square definition is what? It's going to be sum of z1 square plus z2 square plus and so on zn square. So the weak law of large number, what it will imply? So if you recall the weak law of large number, okay, one of the very important result, weak law of large numbers implies that this probability of mod of chi n square by n minus mu greater than epsilon is tends to zero as n tends to infinity. That there we have used the definition of Chebyshev's inequality as well. Okay, means as n goes to infinity means as n goes large, so that actually sitting around the mean, and what is mean here is mean of standard normal random variable, that is 1. Okay, or in other words, what this implies is chi n square by n, what we can say, it is with confidence, you can say with confidence, it can be approximated by its mean, that value is 1, as n tends to infinity. So say with confidence, it can be approximated by this. And hence, this does imply that T distribution, what is this, which is nothing but z by square root of this chi n square by n, is going to be approximated as standard normal random variable as n tends to infinity. Okay, so this is why you can see here 5 degrees of freedom itself, you can say this is a bell-shaped curve itself. Okay, now moreover, you can also identify now the mean of T distribution and variance of T distribution. Okay, so you can verify what is expectation of TL is going to be expectation of divided by square root of chi n square by n. Just now we have seen that TL can be approximated by Z in a long run, you can see. Okay, in a long run, it can be approximated by the standard normal random variable. And it is symmetric about the zero. Okay, so this is why it can be shown, okay, it can be shown that that is going to be mean is going to be zero. Okay, and for, you can say for n greater than 1, not for n equals to 1. Okay, for n greater than 1. Now, similarly, you can also show that variance of Tn is going to be n upon n minus 2. Okay, so obviously here, because in the numerator is n minus 2, it is only valid because variance always be negative whenever n must be greater than 2. Okay, so this you can again do in the similar fashion, okay, what we have done for chi square distribution as well. Okay, so you can find out exercise is find the moment generating function of t distribution. So who is subscribing this lecture, okay, they can fill this gap, okay, because we have already found many MGF. So now it is your practice now how to identify. Okay, now what you observe from here is that is important, that again in the long run you can write this n minus 2 divided by n minus 2 minus or plus 2 divided by n minus 2. So this is equals to 1 plus 2 by n minus 2. So as n tends to infinity, this tends to 1. So this also tells you that in the long run that t distribution anyway having mean 0 always, in the long run, it is the variance is going to converge to 1. Okay, right. Now, we are going to define the quantity like we have defined in the case of chi-square distribution for understanding this t-distribution table. Okay, so here is the one definition. Okay, so which we denote by t alpha comma n. Okay. Which we denoted by p alpha comma n. So for alpha belongs to open 0 1, let t alpha comma n, or the quantity be, I can write the quantity for alpha belongs to 0 1, the quantity t alpha comma n be such that probability of Tn greater than equals to T alpha comma n is equals to alpha. Okay, right. Now, so this we are going to try to analyze through the table. Okay, right. Now, since this Tn is a this t density function, if you look at this t density function is symmetric about 0. So if you look at the negative of this random variable, that also has the same distribution as Tn has. Okay, and so what will happen here is, so from here, since I can write here that since the t density function is symmetric about 0, therefore minus Tn has the same distribution as Tn has. And what will imply this? And so probability of minus Tn greater than equals to T alpha comma n is also alpha. Okay, so this is what it is telling you. Okay, so this implies, so therefore, probability of minus Tn, probability of minus Tn greater than T alpha comma n is also going to be n. So this tells you probability that Tn is less than equals to minus T alpha comma n multiplied by minus, that is alpha. And this implies probability of Tn greater than minus T alpha comma n is equals to 1 minus alpha. So this tells you what, in conclusion, what you will get is this implies T alpha comma n with negative sign is essentially equals to T 1 minus alpha comma n. Okay, so this is the same as if you look at that and look at the definition, 1 minus alpha, the probability with p1 minus alpha common. Okay, right. So now you will proceed in the similar way as you have done in the case of chi-square distribution. Okay, for finding, identifying the probabilities. Okay, like estimating the probabilities also. So we are interested in finding the probability of t12 less than 1.4. So let's look at this table. Okay, again we will look in the same way. So t12 is less than 1.4. So you have to see in the row, that is this t12 with 12 degree of freedom, and we want to see less than 1.4. So this is 1.356. So you certainly look at probability of t12 greater than 1.4. Okay, then 1 minus of this, that will give you. So greater than 1.4 will be nearly about this 0.10, right? Okay, so that you can take as an approximation, that is going to be, you can say, it's very near. Okay, so that's why I'm taking it. Otherwise, what is telling is that the probability is going to lies between 0.05 and 0.1. Okay, so you certainly have 0.05 less than, okay, that probability of t12 greater than 1.4 is going to be less than 0.1. Okay, so that we can conclude from here. Okay, similarly, if you are interested in finding the value t 0.025, 9 from the table, so 9 denotes the degree of freedom is this. Okay, and you have, this is going to be 0.025. So in the degree of freedom, so alpha is 0.025. So this is what alpha. Okay, so this is alpha, this is n. So n is the 9 and alpha is 0.025. So this is the value is going to be 2.26. So this is how you will look at this t distribution table. Or else what you can work is, you can work with the I can write as in a function which you can use in MATLAB greater than 1.4. For this, I can write it that TCDF of 1.4, 12. So this is less than here. Okay, so distribution function is going to be T12 less than 1.4. So whether you include 1.4 or not doesn't matter, because it continues distribution. Okay, so point probability is negligible. Okay, right. So t12 less than 1.4 is going to be q. Okay, right. So now let's move to define the center limit theorem now, finally. Okay, right. So now the very first thing is, we are going to define the sample mean. So how means, like, why this is called sample mean is because, you suppose you consider a population of elements, okay, or you consider a certain society, okay, where you can assign the value attached to each adult might be, you can say, you can list out the main head of the family member, okay, and you can prepare the corresponding values are attached with it is their annual income, you can say, or height or age and so on. Okay, so that will create a population. Okay, and that you can say that is a sample data you have. Okay, right. Now further, you assume that the value associated with any member of the population can be regarded as being the value of a random variable. Okay, so that we are going to as a random variable, that means we are going to identify the the value associated with any member of the population as a value assumed by a random variable. So certainly it will follow, it has some expectation value and it has some variance value, that is called sample mean, sample variance. Okay, that we are going to define. Okay, so you take n number of data means like, suppose from that big data is there, means like suppose you have the list of 1,000 persons. So you take any 10 persons from there or 30 persons of there, you take sample data and look at the sample mean and all. Or you can take the entire sample mean as well. Okay, right. So that we call as the data from that population is called as a sample. Okay, and we are going to respectively say here, let's say here, this see if it is denoted as mean is mu and sigma square. We are going to carry forward the same notation for their sample mean and sample variance. Okay, right. So means okay. So let's try to look at that this definition which is talked about the sample mean. Okay, so let us take x1, x2, xn be a sample of values from a certain population. So that population can be assigned with their annual income or with their height or age or any other data relevant out there, working where, okay, working at up to how much distance from their home. So many other cases are possible. So then the sample mean is identified as the average of them. Okay, so this is a very natural thing. Okay, that is given here. So x bar is going to be used as the notation for defining the sample mean. Okay, so x1, x2, xn, you take the average of them, is you take the sum of them and divide by n. Now see, this is the sum of n random variables. Okay, so x bar is the sample mean is also coming out as a random variable. So it will also have some mean and it will also have some variance that we will calculate. Okay, further, each value or each assigned value we are going to assume as independent of each other. Means those all is xi's are IID, means identically and independently distributed random variables. So are IID random variables. Okay, so we are going to assume that the sample data we have, so where each sample you take, any randomly sample you take, okay, those each value will follow the a random variable. Okay, and then obtained random variables are identically distributed and independent. Means okay, it's very clear that your income is not dependent on the other person, or your height is completely independent of the other, means other member of the other house member, or you can say the neighbor of you. Okay, so this is very natural generalization of this or observations you can see. So we have the sample R follows the IID random variables, and let's say each has the mean mu and variance sigma square. So now you can certainly, I have already mentioned that this x bar is going to be a random variable, and we are going to find out what will be the possible mean and variance. Okay, so it is very easy to observe that mean of x bar is mu itself. So right, it's a very simple exercise. Let me finish it off. So expectation of x bar is equals to nothing but expectation of this 1 by n summation of xi, I is equals to 1 to n. And now expectation has the linear property. So that's why this is equal to 1 by n. Now summation I is equals to 1 to n expectation of xi. Now each xi has the same mean, that is equals to mu. Mu is added up to n times. So you have n times mu. So it is in total is mu. Okay, right. Now similarly, variance of x bar, that is not linear function. Okay, so variance of 1 by n summation xi, I is equals to 1 to n, is going to be equal to 1 by n square. The constant will come out, square outside. So 1 by n square variance of summation xi, I is equals to 1 to n. Now since the sample data is, it means that those random variables are independent of each other, they are identically distributed. So you know that covariances are zero. So this summation, sum of variance of sum of random variables is equals to this independent random variable equals to summation of variance of xi, I equals to 1 to n. So this is equals to sigma square, variance of xi is sigma square n times sigma square divided by n square. So this is going to be sigma square by n. Right? So what you observe as a result, what you can conclude that the sample mean is also centered about the population mean. Okay, so right, because expectation of x bar is the population mean itself, mu. However, it's the variance is sigma square by n. So what it shows is, so its spread becomes more and more reduced as the sample size increases. So if you increase the sample size, that spread is going to be reduced. Okay, right. So this is what we have concluded from this. Okay, right. So now we are going to look at the, see, we have already identified this x bar sample mean as a random variable. Okay, so now we are going to identify its distribution as well. Okay, so but for that part, we require that very remarkable result, which is known as the central limit theorem. Okay, so which is, this is one of the most remarkable result in probability. Okay, and what it gives you that the sum of a large number of independent random variables, okay, no matter whether they are non-normal or normal random variables, okay, that is the distribution, that sum of that n, that large number of independent random variables is going to be, the distribution is going to be approximately normal. Okay, right. So it is not only provides a simple method for computing approximate probabilities for sums of independent random variables, but also it helps in explaining the remarkable fact that the empirical frequencies of so many natural populations exhibits a bell-shaped curve. Means we are going to have here understanding that if you have the population, means like a big data, natural means like okay, means your observation in terms of samples, okay, that is going to be exhibit naturally a bell-shaped curve. Means suppose you have a crowd of 370 students in a class. Okay, so if I go with your your evaluation scheme, and if I'm going to conclude out of 100 marks, okay, and if I'm going to plot on the if I'm going to plot it, it's going to be approximately normal. Okay, now one more important thing is this remarkable result leaves the open question that how much large data should sample have. Okay, so that is it, means there is a general rule of thumb that at least n must be, n is 30. So above n 30, n equals to 30, means more than 30 number of sample size, it is there, it is certainly is going to be approximately normal. But it is not, means like, it is not here necessary that less than n 30, n equals to 30 will not follow. Okay, so there are cases means like n equals to 5 itself. So for them is like just now you have learned the t distribution, okay, which has normal density, okay, with n equals to 5. Okay, it is approximately normal with n equals to 5. You can plot the exponentially distributed population. Okay, there you will also see a bell-shaped curve after some n equals to 5, 10. Okay, so the general rule of thumb says n is greater than equals to 30 is certainly is going to can be approximated by a normal distribution. Okay, right. So let's come to our business now. Okay, so here it is, this result is there. So let x1, x2, xn, this is a sequence of IID random variables. I hope now you are familiar about this word. IID means identically and independently distributed random variables, each having mean, mu, and variance sigma. Then for n large, this summation of xi, this sub n for n large, if you take the sum of these any sample data, you can say, right, because they are IID, you can choose any n number of sample data. Okay, right. So then if you take the sum of these n number of read the variables independent identically distributed that will follow normal distribution with mean so and so and variance so and so approximately. Okay, so it is a very clear why it is n mu and n sigma square. So mean you can certainly find out. Okay, so if you look at back, okay, if you look at back, so what is x bar is nothing but 1 by n summation xi. I is equals to 1 to n. And you have noted down expectation of x bar is equals to 1 by n. Sorry, expectation of x bar is mu, and the variance of x bar is sigma square by n. Okay, so from here you can certainly find out back, okay, what will be the summation xi mean, and what is the summation xi variance. Okay, so that can be certainly find out, okay, by using the similar process here. Okay, right. So in other words, what it tells you is, in the terms of probability, what it tells you is the following. So you have a sample data x1 plus x2 plus xn that will follow the normal random variable. So you know, okay, so you know if x follows normal distribution with mean mu and sigma square is variance, then you know x minus mu by sigma will follow the standard normal random variable. So this is what it is giving you. So you have, this is summation xi. If you see the numerator, is minus 1 to n minus its mean divided by its variance, that is that variance was sigma square n, now sigma root n. This will follow the standard normal random variable. Okay, so this probability, you can always approximate the probability for a sample for a large set of samples, okay, by using the normal table itself, standard normal table itself. That's what it's giving you the guarantee. Okay, so I already explained how many number of at least data is required. Okay, means that will, I mean, this theorem will guarantee that that will be going to have, can be approximated by normal probabilities. Okay, right. So now let's take a quick one or two examples here. Okay, right. So let's take this example. An insurance company has 25,000 automobile policy holders. Okay, so 25,000 is a very large number. Okay, so if the yearly claim of a policy holder, of a policy holder I'm talking about, is a random variable with mean 320 and standard deviation 540, okay, then approximate the probability that the total yearly claim exceeds 8.3 million. Okay, million dollars or million rupees. Okay, so that we want to understand. Okay, right. So now let us see the solution. Okay, so let us denote this x. Let us denote the x is total yearly claim. So it is possible that all 25,000 policyholders may claim, right? Because anything can happen, like this is during this pandemic situation. Everyone can get corona. Okay, right. So then they may claim certainly. Okay, so if they are insured. Okay, right. Now let us denote this xi. Let us denote this xi as this is going to be yearly claim of a policy holder I. Okay, so let's denote this xi as yearly claim of a policy holder I. What if this I value is, I can 1, 2, 3 and so on till 25,000, right? So what is then x? So certainly x is nothing but summation of xi. I is equals to 1 to 25,000. Have to estimate. Okay, now one thing is very clear, that the claim of policy holder I is independent of the claim of policy holder J. Means he will separately claim, I will means you will separately claim, I will separately claim, everyone will separately claim, and independently they will do. So these xi's are independent random variables, and they are given to be normally distributed. Xi's are normally distributed, or is a random variable. It is given that xi's are, if the yearly claim is a random variable, it's not normally distributed, but they are xi with the mean expectation of xi is 320, and variance of xi is, or standard deviation is 540. And standard deviation means so mu is equals to 320 and sigma equals to 540. Right? Yes. Okay. So now, certainly, so CLT, and in short, central limit theorem. So CLT stands for central limit theorem, implies x will follow the normal distribution. Okay, x will follow approximately the normal distribution with mean, that is n times mu, with variance n times sigma square. Okay, because n is 25,000 here. Okay, so I can certainly calculate now n is 25,000, mu is 320, sigma is 540. Okay, so I can certainly find, okay, expectation of x is going to be n times mu means 25,000 times 320. That is, okay, that you can write it down. Okay, we will write it down. Maybe this is going to be, and standard deviation of x, because anyway we are going to transform it into a standard normal random variable, so it is going to be sigma square root of n. So that is going to be 5t into square root of 25,000. Okay, so this is going to be, you have this 10 to the power 4 is there, right? Okay, and what is there is 25 into 32 is 8 into 10 to the power 6, right? And this is going to be come out as 8.5381 into 10 to the power 4, that you will have. Okay, right. So what we are interested in, what is the probability that the total yearly claim exceed 8.3 billion, means 8.3 into 10 to the power 6, it should cross. So this is equals to probability of x minus 8 into 10 to the power 6 mean divided by standard deviation 8.5381 into 10 to the power is greater than 8.3 into 10 to the power 6 minus 8 into 10 to the power 6 divided by 8.5381 into 10 to the power 4. Now this is equals to approximately now probability of Z greater than equals to, now you can minus this 0.3 into 10 to the power 6 divide by 8.5381 into 10 to the power 4. Okay, so now you can, so this is going to be approximately is probability of Z greater than equals to 3.51. Okay, so which you have approximate value is by using the normal table, you can find out 0.00023. So there are only 2.3 chances out of 10,000. Okay, that the total year claim will exceed 8.3 million. Okay, right. Now let's take one last example of the central limit theorem. Okay, then we will wind up by coming. Okay, right. So civil engineers believe that W, the amount of weight in units of 1,000 pounds, okay, that a certain span of bridge can withstand without structural damage resulting, is normally distributed with mean 400 and standard deviation 40. Okay, so require W, the amount of weight. so that there will be, if you have more W, then there will be a structural damage. Okay, right. Now, suppose that the weight of a car, again in units of 1000 pounds, okay, is a random variable with mean 3 and standard deviation 0.3. Okay, so then how many cars would have to be on the bridge span for the probability of structural damage to exceed 0.1? Okay, so here you have to identify how many number of cars, okay, to be there on the bridge. So that is, so what you can do, you can you can take a sample of x1 x2 xn, means you have to find, means which denotes the weight of the ith car, okay, and then you can certainly, so if you take the sum, that will be the total weight of the bridge, and you are trying to identify what will be the possible n value. Okay, so I'm just going to write down, let xi denote the weight of the ith car. We don't know so far how many cars are required, so the weight of the ith car, okay, where I, you can say 1, 2 and so on n. Okay, and we are interested to find, we are interested to find this value of n. Okay, so that probability of the sum, summation of xi, I is equals to 1 to n greater than equals to w should be approximately 0.1. So how many cars would have to be on the bridge span for the probability of structural damage to exceed 0.1? So we require this one. Okay, right. Now we can certainly, we don't have any other way to, rather we are going to look at for central limit theorem. So certainly we require the large number of cars for the same. Okay, so central limit theorem, what it implies, that summation of xi, I is equals to 1 to n, okay, will follow the normal distribution, okay, with mean and mu, and variance is n times sigma square, okay, and it is given that each car is, has the weight is of a car, is a weight of a car is a random variable with mean 3 and standard deviation 0.3. okay, so you have, this is going to be n of n time mu, so 3n comma sigma is 0.3, so 0.09, so 0.09 n. So certainly if you take minus of 3n and divide by the standard deviation, okay, that will follow the normal distribution. Okay, and moreover, the weight of the ith car is independent of the jth car. Okay, that will certainly will not depend on the other cars. Okay, and further, the total weight is also independent of the ith car weight. Okay, so what it will give you is, you can certainly, so this will also further implies, so also the weight W, which is a random variable, okay, the W is a random variable which is given to us, that it is a normally distributed, okay, it is normally distributed with mean 400 and standard deviation 40. Also W follows normal distribution with mean 400 and standard deviation is 40, so 40 square with a value. So therefore, this summation of xi, I is equals to 1 to n minus W. Why? Because minus W we are interested in, because if you look at here, we are interested in summation xi minus W is greater than or equals to, okay, that's what we are interested in. So that's why here minus W will also follows the normal distribution, because sum of two normal random variable is normal. So that we have already seen, that's going to be, and not only that, this and also this W, and W is independent of xi. Okay, W is independent of xi, the weight of the ith car. So then this is going to be 3n minus 400, comma 0.09n minus 40 square. Plus 40 square, because in the variance is going to be plus. Okay, so that will give you, so this implies, I will say summation I equals to 1 to n xi minus w minus mean is 3 minus 4 minus 400 divide by square root of 0.09 n plus 40 square is 1600 will follow the standard normal distribution 0, 1. Okay, so from above, what we can look here is, this implies, so this implies probability of summation xi I equals to 1 to n minus w greater than equals to 0 approximately should be equals to 0.1. This implies probability of z greater than equals to what we have done, minus mean and standard deviation. So this is going to be minus 3n minus 400, 0 minus, so minus 3n minus 400 divide by square root 0.09 n plus 1600 should be approximately 0.1. Now you look at the standard normal table, okay, for which value, okay, in the standard normal value that probability is equals to 0.1. okay, and from the standard normal table you can certainly identify that probability of z greater than equals to 1.28 will be coming out as 0.1. that you can find out from the normal table. Okay, you can say approximately. So this and this both will be true when you have this 400 minus 3n divide by, so minus of 3n minus 400 is 400 minus 3n, square root of 0.09n plus 1600, okay, should be less than equals to 0.28. Okay, so if it is less than equals to 1.28, means z is greater than equals to 1.28, then it will be certainly satisfy this. So this is if and only if. From here you can solve with this inequality and verify that this must be n must be greater than equals to 1.7. Okay, so at least 117 cars are required, okay, for that structural damage with probability x is 0.1. Okay, right. So we can here certainly give you now that the distribution of sample mean, okay, that is again, so see, in the sample mean what we have taken is the sample data, and where each data follows a certain distribution. But CLT theorem gives you that if you take the last number of data, okay, then that summation of xi will follow the, can be approximated by the normal distribution. Okay, so from the CLT implies what? CLT gives you what? Summation of xi follows normal distribution with mean n mu comma n sigma square I equals to 1 to n for large n. So this certainly implies x bar will follow the normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square by n that we have already calculated. And this implies x bar minus mu divided by standard deviation, that is sigma by square root of n. It follows the standard normal distribution with mu. Okay, right. So I can leave one problem as it is in your for your scribe lecture that you can certainly work out. So here you need to use the fact that you can change this x bar into standard normal variate, x bar minus mean and standard by divide by standard deviation, okay, and that you can fill it gap by looking at the normal table. Okay, so if you have any doubt in it, so you can certainly drop me an email for that. Okay, and so now final is you can have the definition of the sample variance. Okay, so the sample variance is can be identified by, if you look, if you go back and check how we have done the variance was expectation of x minus mu whole square. Okay, now if you look at here, what is this? So earlier we have seen, you have summation of xi 1 by n. You have taken the average and that you have identified as sample mean. But here, instead of 1 by n, you have here 1 by n minus 1. Okay, why it is? Because of the sample statistics. Okay, so that is going to give you a good estimator for the variance of the sample. Okay, so that you will learn by, I mean, it's like when you go through the Professor Gagan lecture, you will see that this is going to be come out as the good estimator of the variance when you are estimating this parameter separately. So this is the quantity is defined as follows. So let x1 to xn be a random sample from a distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square, and x bar be the sample mean that you already know what is that definition. X bar is summation xi 1 by n. The statistic S square defined by this formula. So means each random variable is subtracted by its mean and then take the square. Okay, by sample mean. Okay, then if you take that summation of those them and divide by n minus 1 instead of n. Okay, so this is very much important here. One, instead of 1 by n, you have 1 by n minus 1 because of it is going to be a maximum likelihood estimator as well. Okay, in the later case, you will see when you are going to learn those things. And so this parameter or this quantity is called the sample variance. Okay, and it can be shown that expectation of this random variables, because this is again a sum of random variables, so it's again going to be a random variable. And this can be shown that expectation of this S square can be find out that is going to be sigma square, that variance of. And variance of the, what is that variance? Variance of the sample only, each sample sigma square. Okay, right. So that already has been here is there. Okay, so that I will fill it gap here, how this this expectation of S square is sigma square. Okay, and I will give this lecture notes on the Moodle. Okay, thank you.